If a carpenter came to meet me, he saw the tree and what did he see? He didn't see the tree. He saw how many beds I can make out of that tree if I cut it down. How many chairs I can make out of this tree if I can cut it down. A trader of wood came, he only saw how much profit he can make by selling that tree. And everyone would suggest Lao Tzu what to do. Someone would say, oh, you have this tree, why don't you sell the wood? You can gain so much of money. And Lao Tzu just tried to explain to people that what you are seeing in the tree is not actual reality. Because the purpose with which the tree was made, it is already fulfilling its purpose. Why did God make the tree? It was not to make our beds and our chairs. It was put there to provide us shade and to provide us fruit. And each tree in this world fulfills its purpose without asking for anything in return. That is the purpose of life. But when you put this ego within the human being, what happens? We forget the purpose and we only remember what we want, what we want in exchange. And this is the cause that takes us very far away from our struggle, from our original purpose. So one has to understand the purpose of ego also. Ego itself is not good or bad. It's how you use your ego in your life which will in turn make good things or bad things happen. Now someone, like I said in the beginning, that if ego is so bad, why did God put ego in the first place? So it has to do with how we begin to understand this world. When we are all born into this world, aren't we born all helpless? I mean, if I want something, I can't even speak. I cannot even express myself. And it is by the love and nurture of this world that I am capable of understanding this world. It is through the mother's love I begin to understand the world. It is through the father's love I begin to understand the world. And slowly, slowly, the parents' struggle is what makes me. Slowly, slowly, they'll teach me how to talk, how to express myself. But till I do not know how to do that, I'm a very vulnerable human being. And that is why the ego is instilled in us. How? If you take a seed and you feel it, you touch it, isn't the seed's exterior very hard? You know? Now, if you plant the seed, why has God given a seed such a hard exterior? You will say for its protection. Because each seed knows that there is a certain time when it has to grow. Meaning, if it's too hot outside and the seed sprouts, then what will happen? Too much of sun will not let the plant grow, will not let the seed reach its potential. If it's too cold, then also the seed cannot reach its potential. So when the right time comes, when spring comes, when the weather is absolutely right, and the seed realizes that this is the time when I must grow. But the seed knows that if I must grow, what I have to do first is to detach from that exterior that God has given me and let it go. And the moment the sapling lets go of the hard exterior, you see the potential of life within the tree. The tree starts growing, 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 and over time the tree will reach its potential. In the same way, our sages try to explain that we are instilled in ego. Why? Because when we are very vulnerable, how would we know what is right and what is wrong for us in this world? How do we learn to make our value systems? How do we learn to make differences between good and right? What is humane? What is not? So there is a time when the ego will teach us how to step out into the world. And that is a very important lesson. But then when a person reaches a certain maturity, when a person reaches a certain control of his senses, when a person reaches, okay, that he has a realized mind and he understands the potential that lies within him, then in order to grow further and reach his divine potential, the individual also has to shed what? That thing that protected him. Meaning that we have to learn to mature, to detach from our ego. Now what happens is that usually this is the most difficult thing to do. Why? Because ever since we are growing, it is very easy to be attached to your ego. We are all habitual beings. We make our habits, and those habits are very difficult to change with time. But our sages said that reaching a certain maturity is understanding your spirituality. Now, how is that possible? Because I might be 60 years old, I might be a professor, I might be a teacher, I might be a mentor to a lot of people, but I can still be a very immature person. I can be still a very childish person. So age does not signify maturity. Learning a lot of things about the world does not signify maturity. I'm talking about spiritual maturity. Then how do we know a person is evolving spiritually? So I'll give you a very small example. When we all were very small, we all had a favorite toy that meant the world to us. All the girls sitting here, it might be a doll. All the boys, it might be a car or an action figure. Now that toy meant the world to us. Every time we would sleep, the toy had to be next to us in order for us to sleep. We would get up if we wanted to eat, the toy had to be in our hand. If we were too naughty and our parents wanted to punish us, what would they do? They would take the toy and lock it up somewhere. And until we behaved and until we realized what the mistake we made, the toy would not be given back to us. So just to get the toy back, we would, put up a pretense of being very nice boys and girls. And we would try to trick our parents into getting the toy back. I mean, we all did that, because that is all about human experience. But what happened? We gave the value to the toy to control our life. We gave it importance. We gave it a value that we believed in ourselves. If the toy is with us, we are the most happiest child in the world. And if the toy is not with us, then we are the most unhappy child in this world. But now I ask you, where is that precious toy of yours? So someone would say, this is not our age to play with toys anymore. What will the world say? Meaning, as life moved on, the value that you gave to the toy diminished. Because you realize that as I'm growing, this thing that I'm playing with all the time does not suit me anymore. And slowly, slowly, as your value system changed, you started giving value to other things. You slowly, slowly started forgetting about that toy. Now the toy is locked up in some attic, in some box, and we do not even know where it is. Like, it will take us a great search to even find it. So now what has happened is that one thing that you were so attached to does not hold any significance because you do not give it value. So in the same way, our sages try to explain that maturing spiritually, it's not about detachment of the world. That I give up on everything and I go live in the Himalayas. Because if the mind is attached to the world, then it is the thought that will attach it. If I go to the Himalayas, sit in the mountains, and I was a person who was an avid lover of cars or motorbikes, then living in the Himalayas, what will I be thinking on? What I'll be contemplating on? I will be thinking, oh, this new car had to come out, has it come out? This new motorcycle had to come out, has it come out? So if I'm sitting in the Himalayas thinking that I'm detached from the world, I'm no longer attached to Maya, but my mind, because it's attached to the world, has even created a greater Maya, which is called the Mahamaya. And that Mahamaya is only our creation. And that's what we have to realize, that in order to counter the creation of the mind, you have to rise above the mind. That is detachment from the ego. Meaning, you ponder into the world what is the most essential thing, and you attach to that. Now, what is the most essential thing? How are we alive? What is the prime vata which is within us? So that has to be understood. And our sages said that through great struggle, a person begins to realize that. Why? Because life is the greatest teacher. Like if we were in school and we didn't want to learn anything, slowly, slowly the teacher would get strict with us. First the teacher will try to explain with a lot of love, a lot of attention. And when the teacher realized that this person is not willing to learn, then the teacher might raise his voice. Then the teacher might scold us. Then my teacher would use different means to try to scare me into learning. But this only happens when I pose a great resistance to learning. So slowly, slowly, in the same way, when I live a life where I'm not attached to learning about myself, then slowly, slowly, life poses greater and greater challenges. Why? Because life will force you to contemplate on your life. Life will force you to contemplate on your learning. And eventually, you will begin to internalize your search. And when you internalize your search, you will realize what is our true purpose. What is the essence that creates us? So the struggle is that each individual must begin to realize that it is not the circumstances externally that control us. Because it's very easy to play the blame game. Why cannot I grow spiritually? Because God does not love me. Or because the blessing is not present. But if I see, if you just look around you and for a moment just wait and ponder on how great this life is, how complex this life is, you begin to realize that this life, this creation, only complements human life. Why is it that out of millions and millions of beings that are present on this earth, we can think? You take a cow or any animal, they are bound by their natural karma, by their natural action. A cow can give you milk, but it cannot create a rice pudding for you. It cannot. But you look at the human mind, we will take milk, we will take rice, we will combine the two with sugar, and we can create something new and give it to the world. So you look in all the aspects of creation. Why has this world, this creative force existed? It is because we have to realize our purpose in life. And all these things that have happened is to complement us. Now what happens is, if God has created this world to complement it and we are moving in the other direction, then suffering automatically increases. Now what is suffering? Our sages also explain that in different ways. Now suffering itself is so vast, if you begin to contemplate, that what is the cause and effect of suffering, sometimes we can get lost. Because what can be displeasing to you could be pleasing to another person. A sight or a story can be displeasing to another person, but that same sight or that same story could hold a deeper meaning to someone else. So how do you gauge suffering? For an example, there was this couple, they were about to get married. So the would-be wife looks at her fiancé and says that, "Oh my love, when we get married, I will take care of all your worries, all your problems, do not worry about it. I'll be there to share them and take the burden with you." So the would-be husband is sitting down and he contemplates what his fiancé is saying. And suddenly he says to his fiancé that, "My dear, you know, what you say is very sweet, but I do not have any problems in my life. Yeah. I'm carefree, there's no worries, there's no troubles, there's no struggle. So what are you talking about that, you know, you will be there standing next to me taking care of all my problems?" So the would-be wife looks at the husband and smiles. He's like, "Right now, you have no worries, no problems, but the story will change after we get married. So what we do not have today, we might have tomorrow. We might say, 'No, I'm not suffering today, but I might suffer tomorrow.'" So how the mind attaches itself, that is the cause of suffering. The movement of the mind, our sages said, is the cause of the suffering. Suffering is not real, just like our fears are not real. But our fears do govern our lives. I have a job today. What is my fear? That I will lose my job tomorrow. But tomorrow hasn't come. Has it? No? So the thing is that the movement of the mind, that I'm thinking, I'm contemplating that tomorrow this might happen, tomorrow I... It is just my mind imagining things. But the fear in it is so overpowering that I begin to believe in my fear. No, no, tomorrow will come and I will lose my job. What does it do to our present today? It makes us totally unaware of what I have to do today in order to preserve tomorrow. And then what happens? If I'm not doing the right thing today, if I'm not walking the right path today, tomorrow I cannot reach the right destination also. So it is very important to understand how the ego affects the mind, how the ego is the cause of the movement. And once ego is witnessed, only by the power of contemplation and witnessing it, you can detach from ego. How? If you are walking down a path and you see a drain is open, you will not step into it, will you? You will skip over it. But that will only happen when you are looking where your foot is going. If I am talking on the cell phone, and if I am looking in the sky, or if I am looking somewhere else, what will happen? I will fall into the drain. And when I will get hurt, I will say, oh, I did not see the drain. That's why this accident happened. So our sages said that learn from your life, be a witness to your life, and by being a witness, you will come to great realization. But the fact is that we are not witnessing our lives, we are witnessing other people's lives. What this person said, what this person did, and within witnessing all people's lives, we start comparing, the ego starts comparing. What has he got? What have I got from life? And within this comparison lies suffering. Because if we say that everyone should get everything in life, it cannot happen. Because each individual or the soul is in different stages of the journey. For someone, he's in the last leg, and with a little bit of effort, he'll break away from the cycle of life and death. So what he sees and what he views the world as, or what he values the world as, will be completely different for a soul which is just beginning to start his journey into this world. And when he's beginning to start the journey, obviously he'll be burdened with more attachments, more questions, more worries. So what that person is experiencing in the world will automatically differ from the person who's about to detach himself from the world. But what happens is that the mind comes in, the ego comes in, and the ego generates a particular thought. And within the thought, we get lost. So it is very important when our sages said that reach the state of no mind. Now what is the state of no mind? Now when we are born with the mind and the mind enables us to think, and we are all beings that do all our actions on the basis of contemplation or thought. I mean, you wanted to come here, there was a thought within you that I must go to the program, and you made time and you made the effort and you are here. If the thought didn't come that I must go, then I will not be here. I mean, there are enough distractions in America to distract me and make me do other things. I can spend my time doing 100 other things. But a thought which is focused on, which is meditated on, makes us perform a particular action. So in order to do the right action, the right frame of mind must exist. Which our sages says is no mind. Now what is the meaning of no mind? No mind means that when we understand that the thought stems out of ego, do not give it any attention. Let it pass. And when you let it pass, obviously, just like a person chattering, like if you're sitting on a flight and two people are talking behind you and they're not speaking any sense, for a moment you will be very curious as to what they're talking about, you'll give them attention. But when you realize they're not making any sense, slowly, slowly, you will not pay them any attention, even if they are talking very loudly. And once you stop giving them attention, you will realize that their nonsense is not affecting you. But what happens is that when I am too curious and I want to know and I want to say something, then the nonsense they are speaking will have an effect on me. Either I will try to teach them, either I will try to get an argument with them, or I will please tell them to humbly keep quiet, which is a reaction which will cause another reaction. So the fact is that one must understand that the state of no mind is not paying attention to what is not essential. And slowly, slowly, when you begin this experiment within you, you will learn to detach from you what you are not. And once you detach from yourself what you are not, our sages say, in the end, what will remain, that is your totality, that is your pure self, that is your true self. And once you realize that, there is no going back. It's like learning how to ride a bicycle. Once you learn to ride a bicycle, even if you don't ride it for 10 years or 15 years, but that knowledge of riding the bicycle will always remain in you. Because you have struggled, you've fallen multiple number of times. But once you understand the art of balance, it remains with you forever. In the same way, once you understand the right balance of how to walk in this life, how to detach yourself from the non-essential, and focus on the essential. And once you learn this art, once the mind is trained to be focused within here and now what is essential, then that knowledge stays with you. You don't need scriptures to enforce it, because you become a living scripture yourself. So that is the focus that we must all have. There's a very beautiful example of different things, you know, what each individual should do and what affects us, you know. So the story is, it's a five-part story, different stages of the story. So the first story goes as that there was a village which had a great drought and a lot of people were suffering. So all the village elders got together and they said that let's pray to God. And instead of one or two people praying, we'll call the whole village to the village square and all of us will pray for rain. So a time was allotted, a date was fixed. When that day came, everyone gathered in the village square. But there was only one boy who came with an umbrella. So that is faith. This is what faith is. We might have our belief system. Everyone believed in God. That's why they came to pray there. But everyone didn't believe that their wish will come true. But there was one boy who came with an umbrella, meaning he believed that if you all prayed and God exists, then God will listen to our prayer and he will make rain. So only one boy came with an umbrella. That is what? That is faith. We might have beliefs, but belief is very different than faith. So the second story goes, is that we have no clue what is going to happen tomorrow. You know, we have no understanding of what the future holds. But we still make plans for tomorrow. So that gives us the ability to plan for our future. So that is what it is, confidence that tomorrow will come. It is confidence in ourselves, in our belief. If you take a small boy and you lift him up in the air, though it's a very scary experience, but because the boy has trust in you that you will catch him, he enjoys that experience. But if you do it to someone who doesn't trust you, he will first look at you, why do you want me to throw me up? That's the first question you have. Like, what is the purpose of this? But if there's trust, then there is no fear. So trust is very important, faith is very important, confidence is very important. But then the story goes that we don't know if we'll be alive tomorrow. Yeah. But before sleeping in the night, we'll set an alarm for tomorrow, you know, to wake us up. That is what? That is hope that tomorrow we will live. So trust, faith, hope and confidence are very important things to take us further in life. But the person who writes these stories writes another story. He says we all see suffering in this world and we still get married. That's overconfidence. That is not good enough. So no matter how you look at the world, the only way you can learn about this life is through your experiences. That is what we say, Adi Guru. The Guru that has no beginning has no end. What has no beginning and has no end is that force that sustains life altogether. And that force is what we call Adi Brahm. Something that beyond comprehension. That is why in all stages of our journey in life, we have said there are four primordial stages. First stage is the waking state that we all experience. Then there is the dream state that we all experience. When we are not experiencing this waking state and we go to sleep, there's another state that takes over our life. We can dream to be a king, we can dream to be a pauper, we can dream to be anyone in this world. Beyond that state is the third state, which is the deep sleep state, in which you are not even aware of your consciousness. But something still exists, because when you come out of that state, you know you have experienced that state. You went into deep sleep, you have the awareness of that. So something must have existed. But then they say the fourth stage of enlightenment is what? It's called Turiya. But what is that state? It is never defined. Why? Because that is the realm of pure experience. And pure experience cannot be defined. Now many people say, why cannot be defined? Because if I'm having the experience, I can share it with you. Now, in the same, you know, cycle of questions, if I'm to ask a question to you, how does chocolate taste? So you will say, oh, it tastes sweet. But if I say, I have never tasted anything sweet, now explain to me, how does the chocolate taste? Now, aren't you in a fix of words? What word will you use to explain to me the sweetness of chocolate? You will say it tastes like sugar. I'll say I've never had sugar. Now explain to me. Then you will say, oh, it tastes like jaggery, raw sugar. I've never had raw sugar. Someone will say, oh, have you tasted sugar cane? The sweetness of the sugar cane is like the sweetness of the chocolate. But I've never tasted sugar cane in my life. Someone will say, oh, have you tasted a sweet mango? It tastes like. You can give me a multitude of examples. But I can say, I have not tasted anything. Now explain to me what chocolate tastes like. Or sweet tastes like. Or what is the expression of sweetness? Or what is the experience of sweetness? Now, the more words you use, the easier it is for me to deny. But if you want to give me the experience of what a chocolate tastes like, there is no need for words. There is only a simple action that must be performed. You get a piece of chocolate, you put it in my mouth, and you don't need to say anything. You don't need to say any word. Because I'm getting a direct experience of what that sweetness is. And once I've got the direct experience, I don't even need to explain it to someone else. There is no need for words. This is what Lao Tzu said in I Ching also, that the word that is said can never be true, and the word that is not said will forever be the truth. So this is what the wisdom of great masters is, that they give us the empowerment to understand ourselves through ourselves, not something else. Because we are the search that we are searching for. We are all searching in this world for something, not realizing the true potential that lies within us. So it is very important to first make that step to make the journey inwards. And once we do that, then slowly, slowly all things come into perspective. You know, our purpose, the journey we are taking, how to make changes in ourselves, all the things that we practically think it's impossible right now. Why? Because the mind is always fluctuating, the mind is always moving. Before we set our goal, we focus on the challenges. Oh, this is not possible, this cannot be. This is what happened to Arjun also. Arjun was a great warrior, very accomplished bowman. And he goes to Lord Krishna and he says, I can do impossible things with the bow. Because I've trained myself, I've got that skill. If you want me to penetrate the earth and take out water, what we use, you know, drills to do that, you know, I don't need a drill. I can take my bow and arrow and I can take out the water from this earth. If you want me to capture a cloud in a net of arrows, I can do that. I'm so skilled. But what you say to focus the mind, this is the most difficult task for me. I mean, I can do all these impossible tasks. They are nothing. It's just a small play of my hands for me. But to focus my mind is the most difficult task. It practically seems impossible. How am I to do it? And that's what Lord Krishna says. That Arjun, what you say is absolutely true. That it is very difficult to focus the mind. But with constant effort and detachment, you can attain that. You can focus your mind. So that means there is a path laid down. But the path has its certain requirements. And the requirement is what? That we have to constantly struggle with ourselves. It is a moment-to-moment struggle. It is not that I've come to the program and for the next year my quota is filled. I don't have to do anything because I went to satsang, I listened to great wisdom, I have this recorded, I can see it anytime, I can give this exact speech to someone at any time. But that will not make me any wiser. But what does make me wiser is if I constantly practice myself to focus on that moment. Because whatever is gone in the past is only a memory, and what is to come in the future is only our imagination. What truly exists, what we feel, what we experience, is only this present, it is this now. But we do not focus on this now. And in the same way, the egoistic mind doesn't focus on what is essential. If you take a painting and you see a painting, just by seeing the painting, three things are very clear. That the first thing, that there has to be a creator, a painter for the painting, someone who's created it. Because without a creator, the painting will not exist. The second thing is clear, that there's a medium to paint. I mean, colors were used, brushes were used, otherwise how would the painter paint? And the third thing, which is the most subtle, which many people don't realize, is that the most important aspect of the painting is a blank page or a blank canvas. Now, why is the blank canvas there? Because you can have a painter with extreme great talent. You can give him the best instrument, the best brushes in the world, the best paints in the world. But if the painter does not have a black canvas, he cannot imprint what he has, his talent, his vision, onto that blank piece of paper. So what makes the painting is not the painter, or not his skill, or not the medium that he's using. What makes the painter or the painting special is the blank piece of canvas, because that is the base, that is the foundation on which everything can be imparted. Now, in the same way, we have to question what is the foundation of our existence, because that is the most essential, that is the most important. Without the foundation, what is the importance of the mind? Without the foundation, what is the importance of life? Without the foundation, what is the importance even of my thoughts? Now, what is that foundation? Now, if I came to you with a blank piece of paper and I said this paper costs $1 million, you will not believe it. Because the mind disregards it as the most non-essential thing. And I will look at a painting which has some, you know, sketches on it, and I will give it the most value. So this is what sages try to explain. That sometimes how the mind, the egoistic mind, the mind which is in constant movement, how it perceives the world is not the complete reality. And to truly perceive what is hidden, what is there, what is ever present, first of all, we have to be detached from the egoistic mind that pulls us down, that binds us. So the object of releasing yourself also lies within you, is the clarity of thought. And that clarity of thought only comes with constant meditation. When you are meditating, meditating is the easiest way of self-analyzing yourself. Meditation is the easier way of going within yourself. Meditation is the easiest way of detaching from your daily problems. And most of the people I've met who have extreme problems, when I ask them, do you meditate? They very, you know, humbly say, no, I don't meditate. And because we do not meditate, the mind wanders further and further away from us. And that increases our caution. So that is why the sages have given us ancient techniques of meditation. They have given ancient wisdom of experience to us. Now we have to utilize it within our being. And when we are able to do that, we are closer to our goal, we are closer to realizing ourselves.